Hello. Thank you very much for your participation. ISS Kibo Utilization Symposium. We welcome you. And I actually challenged the selection of astronaut that was the first in 13 years. I am announcer of Nippon Television, Guido Tsujioka. I'm going to act as MC. I did not pass by far, and you can laugh at me. And very shortly, new astronaut will come around. I look forward to it, and it's very cool. And I want to see that short movie in a movie theater somewhere. The theme of today is Kibo to the new stage, Road to 2030. So toward 2030, the direction of space development and the pioneers of many industries are going to have a passionate discussion. In this symposium, we are holding this in the place called the Red Tokyo Tower Sky Stadium, which is on the fifth floor of Tokyo Tower, and we are going to have long one day, but it's going to become quick because it is very enjoyable. So I will act as MC. Thank you. Thank you for the great applause. I have housekeeping information, and for Q&A, we are using Slido web system, and the people who are at the venue, in your leaflet, there's a QR code for logging in. Please scan that in your smartphone. And if you are seeing on YouTube, in the overview section, URL is listed. So please go into Slido from there. And if you are seeing from tomorrow and onward, if it is seeing the old archive of YouTube, you cannot actually get the answer from the stage, but please send the question with the questionnaire survey. Now, we'd like to have the actual event. We are going to have Mr. Hiroshi Sasaki, the Vice President of Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency, JAXA, to make an opening speech. Please welcome me with a big round of applause. Mr. Sasaki, please. Good morning to all of you who are here and who are watching the Kibo Utilization Symposium online. And I am Vice President Sasaki, in charge of the International Space Station and International Space Exploration. Thank you for your participation. And this year's Kibo Utilization Symposium is the first time in 3 years that we have holding on face-to-face. So this is a hybrid format. We have online participants as well. And there are various things that happened in the past 3 years. In November last year, there was an official announcement from the Japanese government to participate in the extension of International Space Station until 2030. And also, we had made a decision of the Japanese contribution to the execution. And in the private sector, there was an announcement to actually develop their own space station. Last time, we talked about until 2024. This time, we can talk about until 2030, as well as beyond 2030. And also, not only ISS, but for other areas as well. And also, Mr. Wakata, astronaut, is on orbit right now in the space station. And this is his fifth flight, and he has been actually staying in the space for more than 1 year. And last week, he had outside the station activity. He actually contributed to enhance the capability of the space station. As Mr. Tsujino mentioned, currently we are having the astronaut selection process. And we are shortly going to announce the winner. And we are actually starting to see the future of space. And this symposium is very significant in that sense. In the Kibo, Japanese experiment module, continues to produce many scientific results for health and longevity and the drug discovery. And also, we are holding the On-Earth Robot Programming Challenge as well, and where the even elementary school students are taking part. And also, students are actually participating in the release of microsatellite as well. And there was a Kibo Space Broadcasting Station, and that held an event again during this year, New Year holidays. In this way, JAXA would like to continue to work on various initiatives. And on the other hand, with the All Japan initiatives, we would like to accumulate and develop the technology so that we would like to continue contribute to the human beings' activities on LEO and accumulated technology from Kibo is going to be disclosed to the public sector so that they can leverage them. And the Japanese government considers how LEO is used over or above 2030 and until 2030, how we are going to use Kibo. We are the specialist, and we are making other proposals and providing support. And various organizations and the private sectors and us are holding various discussions. And this symposium discussion will become a great part and will be reflected. The first part in the morning, we have discussion about post-ISS with the public sector participants. And in the afternoon, in the part two, with the participation of the experts, we can have a Japan-US Space Corporation discussion. And part three, we can talk about how to use ISS to achieve high-impact results. And various participants from organizations and private sectors are taking part in. We hope we can have active discussions. I look forward to the symposium, and thank you very much for your participation. Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Sasaki, thank you very much. Now.
So the next speaker is presenting topic of considering the ways of Japan's LEO activities from a viewpoint of the post-ISS era. We have presenter Mr. Shirakawa Masaki, the director of GEM Kibo Utilization Center. Hello, Shirakawa is my name. I'm head of the GEM Kibo Utilization Center. I would like to talk about our activities towards post-ISS era. To set the scene, and the title is rather rigid, but I have a subtitle called Current Situation and Future of LEO Kibo Utilization. So I would like to explain to you what is happening and the challenge going forward. I have a very short video for you to see. Thank you. So this indicates our activities of intra-vehicular activities. That is, this is a Kibo module, extra-vehicle and intra-vehicle activities. Well, this is a microgravity environment. Because of that, we can utilize various activities. This is a higher quality crystallization of protein, and this may be good for drug delivery and also the human body. Because of the gravity on the Earth, we have muscles being maintained. However, up in space, you have to do exercise in order to keep bone mass as well as muscle mass. But animals don't do any exercise in the space, so they can degrade their body quite rapidly. And we see the degradation in the space using the animal. And this is the cell culture. For example, a kidney cell may be brought into the space so that we can do some experiment to do some activities for regenerative medicine for reproducing kidney or any human organ. And also for material, this is electrolevitation furnace. We measure at high temperature the material. However, this is going to go into the vessel. Therefore, in the on the Earth, we may see something melting away from the vessel, so we can use this environment to separate what is the target and what is not. And also, this is a release of microsatellites. Some of the countries maybe experience this for the first time, and we do this from Tsukuba. And these are the things that can actually make use of ISS for other countries as well. Now, shown here at the very bottom, you see the LEO activities. As was mentioned, until 2030, we know that the extended utilization of Kibo will happen, and that will be agreed by the Japanese government. And this is going to be a platform for research activities. And on the right-hand side, you have post-ISS, and we have some expected environments shown. We have results delivered by Kibo, and we would like to see that happening after post-ISS. And also, we want to see development of facilities after ISS operation will be over. And also, we want to make sure environment will be given to the private sector so their ideas and businesses will be used flexibly. So we have two axes for 2030. One is to maximally utilize Kibo so that we can deliver results at the maximum level. And also, we want to do activities for the post-ISS. So there are two major items that we need to work. And also, in the box, we have three items. One thing is to link current Kibo to the future. And the second is to expand utilization by private sector for commercial use. And third, which we will be discussing later, but we want to make sure Kibo will be utilized even in the ISS is over. Next slide, please. So this is our activities relating to connecting or linking. On the left-hand side, you see a development of new experimental devices. We are trying to make our experimental devices more sophisticated and also make efficient, like a live imaging of the live body. And also, this is at the bottom, see the combustion experiment devices. And also, 3D culture, cell culture is another device we have. And also, with the AMED, we are doing joint research for protein. And also, in order for the data to be captured by Kibo widely available, we are working also with the Tohoku Medical Megabank organization for bio data so that everyone can have access to this. And also ELF data is stored at the Institute of Material Science so that this can also be used by other people as well. And also this is expansion. You see number of experiments happening at Kibo. You'll be counting one project by one. And if you look at the lower bottom, this is the scientific experiment. You don't really see much of the change year by year. However, the overall experiment is growing. Factors for the growth is something that is new. In other words, a new environmental experimental environment on Kibo can increase the number of experiments. So in the center, you have paid experiments. On top of the conventional experiment, we are able to accept the paid experiment as well. For example, using video cameras in the vehicle or maybe outside of the vehicle, we can make sure those cameras would also be used by outside parties as well. Now, for utilization, on the left-hand side, you see some of the photos in the video that will be expanded for the future activities. The highly impactful scientific research is the one we are watching. Until 2030, in order to connect beyond 2030, we need to start research that can deliver extremely high impact. And on the right-hand side, we have flag missions. This is going to be discussed in part three. Social challenge solution and creation of knowledge. Those are the ones that we will be publicly soliciting for the experiment. And also, we want to make sure standardized protocol will be used for utilization of the facilities as well. And also, just yesterday, we made public the pre-announcement page of the web for this solicitation. So anyway, connecting, expanding, and utilization, those are the theme for our activities for post-ISS era. And we have some information on our website, so please visit. Thank you very much, Dr. Shirakawa, for your presentation. And please go back to your seat. Now, we would like to start the program. Now, in the venue here, this is a Tokyo Tower, but we want to move to other venue for the conference. So let's go. I think my little dream came true. It's wonderful. It looks as if I am sending this program from the space station. I'm working for a broadcasting company, but it's really amazing that the Nippon TV station can make a broadcasting from a space station. But I feel really feeling high, isn't it? Sorry, I'm standing in a very strange place. But anyway, we would like to start part one of the ISS keyboard utilization symposium. The part one theme is the private sector plays the main role, LEO utilization in the ISS, post-ISS era. Part one is actually divided into three parts. We have a government discussion, and also as well as a private sector discussion. Now, first part is a private sector discussion, correction. The first part is the discussion what kind of business as possible is a post-ISS era. And after the break, we can have a discussion about how seamlessly we can connect ISS JAXA's activities to private sector. We want to see some aspiration for Kibo. Now.
So the first program of the first part, the chief engineer and the head of the post-ISS study team of JAXA, Mr. Hirohiko Uematsu, would give us a presentation beyond 2030 and the prospect of the post-ISS era. Please welcome him with big round of applause. Good morning. Thank you for the kind introduction. I'm the chief engineer. My name is Uematsu. So I'm also the head of the post-ISS study group team. So before the panel discussion of the first part, I would like to provide some topics and give a brief introduction and presentation. Next page, please. First, after the 2030, for the ISS retirement, various companies are discussing how we're going to do about post-ISS. And until 2030, we decided to extend the ISS operation, and JAXA has started to have the full-fledged discussion of what we're going to do after 2030. Next page, please. So I'm sure you all know this, the U.S. commercial space stations, the Axiom Station, Axiom, and Blue Origin, Orbital Reef, and Northrop Grumman's station, and Nanorax. And all those space stations are being discussed and designed, and the Japanese private sectors are showing a strong interest, and Kanematsu Corporation and also Mitsui companies have announced the partnership with those companies. So in this post-ISS era, the JAXA has started the study team and discussing the post-ISS era and how we would proceed for that era. So in the 2040, that is our first target. And what would be the should-be state of 2040? And we would backcast from that. And this is a simple diagram to show that. On the left-hand side is the current ISS, led by Japanese government, and JAXA is operating. And most of the usage is by JAXA. But on the other hand, the right-hand side would be the 2040 should-be state in the post-ISS era. So it's going to be led by private sector and operated by private sector, and JAXA or the government would be one of the users and continue the LEO activities. And the most important thing is that Japanese government would leverage the strength and show a strong presence. Next page, please. So this is a JAXA's vision for post-ISS activities. So within the team, we had a discussion. Mainly, there would be four categories. So one is the Japan-specific building and operating and usage of the LEO station. Second is the Japan-US private sector partnership to secure the station space. And the third is academia, government, and industries would actually purchase the use from the US commercial stations. And the fourth would be the short-term stay and satellite type and the short-time experiment and the collection system to be developed and used. So those would be the four major categories. So as JAXA, currently, the most rational category would be the second one. That is our current standing. But it's not to reject other options. For example, this fourth option would be like a backup plan of the number two option. So in the post-ISS era, commercially, there would be a space travel or entertainment. Those could be the possible usage area. So as JAXA and the Japanese government, what kind of areas do we continue to use the low Earth orbit? First is to solve the social problems and the scientific experiment for that, and also the preparation for exploration, and we will do the pilot testing, and also other areas that are listed on the slide. So those would be the areas that we will continue to use low Earth orbit for our activities. This year, so we would have more specific discussions on how we are going to have the post-ISS era and for the sustainable. This is a scenario study to achieve the sustainable LEO space environment utilization. And the five companies we have the delegates for the speakers from those companies. So we have identified those as five companies that we partner with. Let me summarize. In the post-ISS era, the private sector will play the leading role, and JAXA and the government would be on the user side. And at this point, it is most reasonable to use the opportunities that we created through the cooperation between US and Japanese companies. And the most important thing is that it is desirable that Japanese companies would show a strong presence and for Japanese companies to make profits so that they can continuously have this business. With that, technologies and know-how that we have obtained so far would be succeeded and maintained and to be advanced to the next level. Next page, please. here at the U.S. Commercial Space Station, the image of the final state. And this is just one example of the ongoing LEO activities. So in the space development of LEO is not really changing. It's having already changed, in my opinion. We are already entering into a new era, and we are standing in the new era. For the past several decades. So I have been working in the government-led space development industry. My way of values or ways of working might not be suitable in this new era. Maybe my way of thinking is outdated. So I always question myself. So how can we adapt ourselves to this new era? So that would be the biggest challenge that we are facing. Today, today's panelists, we have many people from the private sector who are sensitive to these new changes, and we would like to receive frank opinions so that we can get some good hints so that we can move towards the next era. So that is the opening presentation from me. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Uematsu. So the background was like, you know, so great. I thought he's going to be introducing the new smartphone or something. Thank you. But yes, to make the profit and like adapt ourselves to the new era, those would be the very key important. So now we would like to start the panel discussions.
So beyond 2030, a business chance of 400 kilometers of altitude. I would like to welcome all the panelists. Please come on the stage. Thank you. There's one astronaut here. Is that okay? Please take a seat. Thank you. First, I'd like to introduce the panelists here. First, so first in the world should be first in the Kanematsu. Tsushi Takata from Aerospace Department of Kanematsu Corporation. Thank you. I am Takata from Kanematsu. I hope I can have a positive and active discussion with you. Thank you. You are drawing most attention now. And actually took the examination of the selection of astronaut, but I failed. So I wanted to feel like astronaut. Oh, I feel like the fighting friend, like a friend who fought the same fight. And next is the business actions in space. Next is Mr. Ryo Yoshizawa, and he's the head of BU of IS Platform Business of Space BD. And thank you very much. I am looking forward to this discussion with you. And Mr. Takata from Kanematsu actually took a lead. I feel like I'm behind. And Mr. Ryo Yoshizawa is a great name. I think people who are seeing this will think it's great. So Ryo Yoshizawa is an actor who acted in Kingdom Tomb, so maybe people actually expected to have him on the stage. And it's a great name, and you are also drawing attention. Next is the value for this space, Mr. Shingo Horiguchi, the CEO of Digital Plast. Thank you. And they actually draw all the attention. So I want to have a great talk so that I can draw attention as well. It must be very hard to be the third speaker after those two gentlemen. Yes, I'll work hard. Okay. With that aspiration, move the world. Mr. Yuda Yamamoto, project leader of Mitsui Corporation. And thank you. With JAXA, I think we have the same target, same objectives. And the people are actually pioneering the area that there's no ways or path yet. And after astronaut and after those two gentlemen, how I can actually play a role, that was what I have been thinking about. It is sensitive that I'm going to seek out a good balance in taking part in this panel discussion. There are some people who are watching this who do not know about the space. And Mitsui Quoted actually are doing space activities. People may be surprised to hear that. In the history of the company, we had space business activities, but because of various reasons, we had to shrink that business with the various reasons. Yes, and we re-entered that market, and we are moving on to the next phase. Thank you. Next is design the people and the space for the future. And this is Mr. Naohiro Sato from Japan Manned Space Systems Corporation, General Manager of ISS Utilization and Operation Department. And I'm actually in the new space. Actually, those gentlemen are in new space to explore. But in our company, we have been developing the business in the space-related business for the past 20 years. So we have been long-lasting ones. We are old people. Oh, no, no, you are not old. You are okay. Thank you. Okay. Mr. Uematsu, Post ISS, Chief Engineer, and from JAXA, Mr. Uematsu is going to also continue to be on the stage. And the coordinator or moderator is co-founder and director and CEO of Space Time Foundation. And you have very long title. And Mr. Masashi Sato, please, you are going to be a moderator. And actually, you talked about the slogan for each company. I did not get that. I would miss that. And what should I say as a slogan? We are actually trying to create momentum for these space activities. And we are trying to create a great movement for the space activities. Okay, so you are the right person to moderate this panel discussion. So I will actually hand over the microphone. And I was thinking I should not talk about this astronaut suits to proceed the panel discussion, but Tsuyoka-san, you talked about that, although I thought I should be quiet about that. But we cannot ignore that. It is actually drawing a lot of attention. Thank you. As Mr. Uematsu mentioned in his presentation, what JAXA does, that is a continuous LEO activities, and those five companies are considering the scenario for the utilization. And as was mentioned, Mitsui quoted, what are you doing in the space activities? Various companies who were new in the space activities here, and also startups also here, and those who are participating do not know what each company is doing in the space. So, as Mr. Uematsu mentioned, the future utilization of Kibo and also post-ISS commercial space station, what are the thinking that you have currently? I would like to ask you, each person, to talk about your view. So what would you like to actually have a systemized or organized the way of discussion? And there are various ways of using space station, but there are roughly three categories. One is the protein crystallization was mentioned. And in the daily work or daily life of on the Earth, and actually space station actually do something that actually contribute to the daily life on the Earth and provided good value. And another one is on-orbit infrastructure is expanded so that the human being can do activities in the space or on the orbit. It's like a space trip can be also one of the examples so that we can have a wider area where the human being can act. And the third is Artemis, so that it's Moon and beyond or Mars or in the farther area of LEO, and we may be able to have space stations or space activities in the far area. That's the third category. So in those three categories, I'd like to ask each one of you to discuss what are the actions or activities that you have in each company. So for those who are not so familiar about the space activities, please give clear or simple explanation. You don't have a slide, so it may be difficult to explain. So maybe I'd like to ask you first. Yes, in our company, we have never used ISS. And as Mr. Santo, you talked about the three categories. We like to contribute to all three categories. And why Kanematsu, as a trading company, is entering this business? We have various businesses, the food, the steel, and the plant. And we can have a synergy effect from the space activities. And I think we can actually create a good momentum in the Japanese business activities or Japanese economy. That is our thinking. And we'd like to consider how to utilize. And sorry to have this attire, but by going to the space with the private sectors, we can have a larger economic zones, and we can create a new world.
Thank you. I think Kanematsu is working quite actively with U.S. companies. What are you doing now? Now, we are mainly importing products, but because of the technology Japan developed, we want to make sure those technologies are evaluated and also bought by the U.S. So that will be our mission. And also utilization technologies of Japanese activities, maybe that can be used by U.S. as well as other countries. So those are the feature of our activities working with U.S. companies. Now, let's ask this question to Yoshizawa-san. What do you think? Now, BD, you said about the release of micro satellites. Maybe from GEM module, you can release satellites. I think you are doing this with JAXA already. Are you going to do the work on extension of that? What's your plan? Now, Sato-san, you indicated three categories before. So we are doing business in all of these three categories. Space BD was created in 2017, and we are a venture company of 7 years old. Now, number one, this is the relating to the Earth. As was mentioned by Mr. Shirakawa, protein, high-quality crystallization. We are actually developing the business as a partner so that we can do utilization of this facility after post-ISS. And secondly, we are doing a satellite launching service or a delivery service or arrangement for that. That's on-orbit activities, and also technology demonstration utilizing LEO satellite is activities of ours as well. And also Artemis project, people say that in the moon there is a water, so a technology development project management is probably our activities of category three. Topic that you mentioned. Now, today we are talking about post-ISS, how a geostationary station can be utilized for our activities. So I think number one will be important. In other words, returning the benefit to the Earth is quite important. But how we can involve other people would therefore become quite important so that we can make business or make profit out of that. Thank you very much for your input. All of that is quite important. National project or public project, you are working with them, but eventually, as was mentioned by Yoshizawa-san, making money is quite important because otherwise you can't sustain your business. And then you have to identify customers, JAXA or space agencies or users. How can you deliver businesses for those people who are very important? Yes, indeed. Now, what will be the utilization of space by other industry? We have to explore such opportunities from here onward. So I see opportunity, and I'm thrilled to try finding that.
Thank you, Mr. Yoshizawa. Now, Digital Blast, Mr. Horiguchi,
what are you doing now? Now, this is quite difficult for our case, very complicated. But the trading company and after trading company, the presentation was done by two trading company people, and you ask me what we are doing. Roughly speaking, those who are interested in space activities, we want to increase the number, and that will be the basis of our business. So we do a lot of many things because of that. One thing that we are focusing on is the commercial station, free-flying commercial station in the space. We want to operate that as a prime contractor. And 2 months ago, we applied for that, and that's one activities. And also space business. What are we doing more in concrete sense? Life science area experimental devices on the space station. That's what we are developing. And already in 2024, we will have such a device stationed on the station so that we can do projects. And other than that, there are so many things we are doing, like events, like this sort of things. Thank you. Commercial station to be brought to Japan, that's what you said. Like, you say you are going to create something. Are you going to create something from scratch? Well, if you ask if we are going to build something from scratch, maybe that all depends, but the GEM technologies or technologies used and developed in GEM will be the basis. And then Mars or the Moon, or maybe interplanetary activities, and also natural resources on the planet are something that we are also interested in. So utilizing technologies of Kibo, we want to design something that can be benefited, and that's what we are thinking of doing. It will take time, I think. So life science will be the earlier projects, I think. How can you make money out of that? I think two people ahead of you mentioned that, but I can't really picture that idea. Well, regarding life science, are we making money? Well, our business model is something I have to explain first. The life science users, are there many of them? If you ask, maybe I should say maybe not. Maybe we have to find out those customers, and that will be the phase of our business for life science over the future of the space. But the life science structure as an industry is that you have R&D and drug delivery. Then you have to verify the efficacy. And then you have to make business by distributing drug. So altogether, it will take like 7-8 years. So area is quite lengthy, long-term business. But depending on how you design experimental equipment, I think you can shorten the R&D or drug delivery time. Then it can shorten and it can also reduce the cost. So drug delivery value chain start with basic research. University results may be bought by pharmaceutical companies, but initial development can be done in a space. Is that what you mean? Well, that's only the beginning part, but the verification process will take 7 years. And if that can be done in space, the activity can be quite efficient, so we can make a business. So you can make a better thing or make a better data if you do that in the space. Yes, that's what I think.
And to prove, and at the same time, to the pharmaceutical companies you can actually sell. And that's the value chain. And is that the same idea with the other people? And thank you very much. And Yamamoto-san, please. Thank you. And your company, in 2018, we actually have the business to release a micro satellite, and we started to work on ISS, using ISS. And post-ISS, in that context, what we would like to achieve is after Kibo's retirement, Japan should be able to use the private sector commercial space station or module to have it on the LEO and utilize that. That's what we would like to do. In order to do so, the mission we have, what we would like to achieve, I think there are four folds. One, is as Japan, we like to have a good place to work on. And second is by having that place, we like to create a large economy based on that place. And the third, by having this place, the technology and know-how that Japanese companies actually accumulated can be put on that place. And lastly, as Mr. Uematsu mentioned, the private sector should take a leading role. So we can have space development, which is different from the past, that will actually lead to the exploration. Currently, the Japanese government, national government does the exploration, but in mid and long run, a private sector may be able to take the leading role there, and then the technical maturity will be higher, and Rio activities can be done by private sector. That is the new way of space development. That's our mission. And why we want to do that? Why us? Because we think we can help. That is the area that we can be useful. It is a long run for 2030 or beyond 2030. That is a 10-year span. So we need to have a big capital, like 30 billion or 50 billion yen will be required as a capital. And non-space related people need to take part in as well. And we have to actually align with the US platform. Considering that, this may require the Mitsui culture that can actually help because we are a comprehensive trading company. So that's what we would like to support. Thank you. I have two questions to you. One is when you say creating the place, that is an interesting approach. And it is a very profound and big actually vision, which is something that the Japanese company is not so good. Usually, the government makes a place and involves the private sector. But what Mitsui is doing, are there any concrete examples? I think we have a Japan unique way of doing this. Because Axiom Space is the company that we actually work with, and we have partnership. And for the launch business, we are working with SpaceX. And the U.S. Space development dynamism is what I really feel. Should we just apply that to Japan as is? No. I think we should have Japan unique way. Do you want to become Elon Musk? Maybe not. On the other hand, we have to have a different approach from past. That is requiring a good balance. And you said the place creation, maybe space station is one possible place. And from my point of view, from the current like perspective, we can actually stretch our idea. And what is the achievable way? We have actually accumulated technology in the past 10, 20 years for the development and operations. We have resources, people, know-hows of development. How can we actually do this in a low-cost way and how we can make it in a valid business? That's what we are doing in terms of verification of the business validity. Of course, there are risks. And to have asset of like tens of billions of yen, and we have nation to nation cross country relationship, that risk was kind of ambiguous. But we need to have a solid risk management for the next 5 years, 10 years. We have to have a solid approach for risk management. Yes, last point, that's what I wanted to ask, because this is true with Kanematsu. Your company does various activities, and doing the space activity is a big decision for a company, I think. And the LEO or utilization or having a station is very new. Considering the launcher or micro satellite, this is very new. It is hard to see in the future. You may have a big risk of having a huge asset. So to get the approval from the company, how can you do that? And how do you make decision? Well, in 10 years, there's a big, big potential. That is the reason why we can make decision. And in 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, we have been working on this. We have to consider the target and the magnitude of the target, and also significance to the Japanese society and contribution to the social significance. And we want to make it into a valid business as well. But we have to consider how we can do that. Approach is also important. We cannot just spend 10 billion yen. No. So first, we actually invested in Axiom. And by doing that, we can understand what is happening in the state-of-the-art area, and we can have a joint approach with them. And we have investment means in the company. That's what makes it possible. And with the microsatellite release, we have technical know-hows in the company. So by using that, we can expand the utilization. And not only utilization, we have the development needs in Japan. So by actually getting the know-hows and knowledge from those partners, we consider what we can do in the development, and we can move on to the next phase. And when we do that, what's the development cost, what's the business that can happen, we actually taking that phased approach. I think that's what we need to do. Thank you. I think the important trigger is the activity in US. And of course, in Japan, we have assets, but we would like to leverage the assets in US because the development is going on. And those people who do not know the space may find it easy to understand in terms of how we can do that. And we are going to have Japan-US cooperation. And Mr. Uematsu mentioned about the four things. And there was one that's related with that. And that's rare for Jaksha to say that. I think that's an important point.
So, Sato-san. Well, there are two Satos, so I was wondering how can we call you? Well, I'll give Sato away, so Kyo is maybe how you can call me. It's Nao, but my Chinese character read Kyo as well, so you can call me Kyo-san instead of Sato-san. Now, I think you have been working with the Kibo longest among us as a private sector company. You see the change in trend. What do you see? Now, as I said, when Kibo was launched, I have been involved with utilization. Our company was built in 1990. So ever since the development of Kibo and preparation for the operation and Columbia crash happened, and beyond that, we reached the launch. So we were a private sector partner in that, and infrastructure is the nature of Kibo, and our control team is operating Kibo 24/7. Operation is a mission for us, and also we have to create new path. How can we expand utilization is also our mission. So JAXA's utilization is one thing, and also four companies that you mentioned, we are in dialogue with four of them, and what sort of platform and what kind of devices may be utilized and so on and so forth are the topic of discussion. 2008, when GEM was launched, I was in the control center for communication, and Mr. Hoshide was launched. I was actually watching how he was into the space, and I felt that, things have started. Now, I was watching Kibo on the ground in Tsukuba, but now we saw Kibo module completed in the space. I really felt something has changed. But our new people, they know ISS ever since they joined the company, but I saw the history of ISS in evolution. I think I have a responsibility to pass this down to the next generation because this is something we have started. The technology and the skills that we developed over time need to be passed down onto the next generation as my mission. So you happened to start it, or you started, or things started. That's how you felt. Right. I think all of the, you who are in JAXA as well, everyone involved felt in that way, I think. But anyway, our company do LEO, and also exploration is another area, so we would like to expand our business. So long as a Kibo will be operational, we'll make sure that will be operational. And also, we have to think about post-Kibo. like a commercial space station, a smooth shift to that is one operation that we need to think, because we are living in the space, outer space, so we have to deliver values for our business in that. And also we have new people joining the company, so we do have responsibilities for them as well. Gemma says, you are involved in various many things. Now, Kyo-san, personally, where do you think is a growing area, or what is a realm that you want to focus on going forward as an individual? Well, market potential and my aspiration is different. Now, a space stay will be a market going forward, and there will be many capabilities required. But as you said, there are only about 10 or so people up in the space, so there is far away from so-called ecosystem. Many things have to be sent from the Earth. Drug delivery is one thing, and also material development is another. We do have to do a lot so that the benefits can be brought on the Earth, as well as we keep the infrastructure up in the space. So LEO to a moon surface, and everyone is saying that we need to create a sort of society or community up on the moon surface. So that will be the extension of our activities going forward. Thank you. So when you start new business, what are the challenges that you face? I think we don't really have much of the time, so I will give you one big theme. To link the space economy to the Earth economy, you need to work and you need to share the opportunities with people from other industries, right? So those people like pharmaceutical industries, what do you think they understand the opportunities for space business? Do you feel market expanding? Now, this is quite a difficult one. As I said, the protein is one of the business, and we are talking to or approaching the pharmaceutical companies every day, but the opportunities up in the space is not so much known by pharmaceutical people. And how can we do that is a very big challenge. Maybe we want to see overwhelming success. Of course, success is a matter of how you measure. But as an economic activity, we want to make a success for us, like a venture. Maybe we go public or go IPO. Anyway, we have to have some tangible, visible success case of doing something in space. And then that can attract people joining the space business. So, sorry, maybe you were having a hard time hearing me, but that's how I feel. So, success case. Startup has a mentality of trying to deliver a success case, so I think it will be quite suitable. What is your challenge for increasing awareness, or what do you think of doing? Now, Kyo speaking. Now, I have opportunity to have a public speaking or lecture vis-a-vis drug delivery people, and they say they are interested, and they come to my speech, and some of the contents are quite popular. But if I ask, are you going to use our service for your business? And they say, no idea. Now, we do business or communication with space pharmaceutical people, but they don't really maybe understand what can be the benefit of space.
You can have clear protein crystallization. Yes, it's true, but some people want that, but other people do not. And if they are not interested in that, that's the end of the story. But when you go to the space, no convection, or uniform mixing, and the crystallization becomes very clear, not only the protein and Z-plant fiber. And on the Earth, it is not high quality, but in the space, it is high quality. And the effect of space activity, how to communicate that? We have to have a concrete example, and also we have to have emphasize the story that it's shown, and that it's effect to communicate. That is very important. A different environment and the physical activity, action, that actually needs to be explained. That can lead to the business, yes. And I talk about the big talk can be created in the space. And a concrete example is necessary. And also abstracted explanation is also necessary. That can lead to solution to some challenges. And those who are related with space activities, please consider that as the effect of space activities. So technical and also physics. And also entertainment and the image. Also, we need to communicate that as well. And are there any people who can talk about the initiatives or challenges that you may feel? Can I? Yes. And if it is in the space station, that is the space business. And then the utilization and also size matters. And as an economy, can we expand that? It can become very difficult if we consider about the physical things. So digital technology, we have to incorporate that. I think that's what we need to do. For example, virtual reality is one. And actually, we can actually shoot the images and distribute and then charge it to the people. And I think that can become a business model. That the space can be amplitudeed. And that is virtual or digital. And we can combine that with the space activities. And IT investors or entrepreneurs, we have to stimulate them. That is very important for us to do so. The private sector companies, there are some companies who sell the controlling rights of a micro satellite and then take photos of that, or take video of that. And we can share the usage. Yes. We are running out of time. And Mr. Uematsu, what do you think? Do you get the inquiry from outside people? So the utilization about the private sectors, what do you think? Yes, I've been involved with space activities for tens of years. And what I feel is the recognition is not as high as what I would think. And when we actually open our center to the public, many people visit us. And also when we think about myself, sometimes the people actually talk to me, they get interested in the space by seeing the movie called The Space Brothers. Or they go to the presentation of some astronaut, they are interested in the space. And that kind of people are quite limited. How can we increase the number of those people who are interested in the spaces? That is the challenge, I feel. If we do the same things as past, that's not going to work. Thank you. The recognition of JAXA and the attraction of JAXA is great, but only you attract people who like space already. That is natural, and that is okay, but those people who are working in the various industries are becoming a hub, and I think you are increasing the people who are interested in the space. How can we expand further? How can we accelerate? That's the challenge we are going to tackle, and that will become the part two of the panel discussion. I think we are running out of time, so can I conclude this now? Yes, thank you. It's greatly interesting. Are you okay? Yes. And you talked about the quite realistic story. Mr. Uematsu is here. The JAXA person is here. That is interesting. And Kyo-san. And no idea. That is a realistic. That is a reality. That it's actually realized. I realized that the reality. And we have part two of this panel discussion. And those who are viewing this may wondering, can we make money? Or what's the effect of the space activities? I think those are the things that you may want to talk about. And can you talk about that? Yes, as was discussed, how can we use that? And how a lot of industries can get involved, that is not clear. So how to visualize that is what I think we can do.
because I felt the challenge, I dressed in this way. Right, if everyone is in business suits, maybe it's not exciting, and I have a the logo, and JAXA is doing cable broadcasting. So I think this can be outreach for JAXA. If they do so, maybe many more people will be interested in the space. So as we move towards private actors, I think those activities need to increase so that everyone will be interested in space. You have a space suit here, but the space, people feel that it's someone else's. Like if you graduate from science technology department, you can't do or you can't say anything about space. But like he did, you are making space fun. Yes, seriously. So this type of activities is also a charm for those who may be interested in space. So doing this will be a very important step. So, Mitsuibu-san, I think you do have your own way, right? Now, the essential value of the space, Horiguchi-san's entertainment and also Kyo-san's biomedical, those are the values. So if everyone knows about the space and everyone knows about the benefit, what will be the cost and the risks? Those are still the concern remaining. But if we can think about solid application, even there is a risk or big money involved, probably that's the beauty of doing something in space, and that's something we have to do. Well, desire for human being or business, I think making money is quite important. So probably that will be something that I would like to hear more. To make money, this has to be done, and we have to do this and that. I think everyone is still hiding that answer. And also, they may have some requests to JAXA. So why don't we tell everything aloud? So if JAXA wants to do something, maybe JAXA can come on and say things. Well, we have so many people. We can have a sort of a debate and discussion fight. But anyway, let's have a 10-minute break here. Now, after this, we will start from 40 minutes past 11. So we have about 10 minutes break so that we can have an even deeper discussion or maybe more realistic discussion. So please stay and come back. Thank you.
Thank you for waiting. So we would like to have the latter half of the first part of the discussion. And this is what we should do now toward 2030, succession and advancement of JAXA project. So, you know, please don't be like too businesslike all of a sudden. You seem to be so casual before. So Sato-san, please be the facilitator continuously. Yes, thank you. And all the panelists, thank you. Yes, we talked about our challenges, and we just touched on that, and we had just a break. So in the latter half, so how we can overcome those challenges, and towards the 2030, what we should do, especially the public-private partnership is really key in JAXA and the government, and also the private sector, how we should partner. So there should be challenges there as well. So that's what we would like to discuss. So first, we've been talking about post-ISS. And I do not have a clear idea yet. When we say post-ISS era, so Kibo is one of the modules that are attached to ISS. And what are waiting beyond that? And for Japanese people, Kibo would be one of the entries. So in 7 years' time, when the ISS retire, So in the remaining of 7 years, what do we expect Kibo to do? And after the 8th year, what can we succeed? So I would like to receive feedback from the private companies. And in the remaining time, how you would like to utilize Kibo? And are there other things that we should be doing outside of Kibo? Yamamoto-san, may I ask you first? So how do you see position? And you are collaborating with overseas companies. How do you position Kibo? Kibo is very important, in my opinion. So with a public-private partnership and the post-ISS strategy needs to be developed. So development and operation and utilization. So those three are like trinity. And as Japan, we have invested quite a lot of money in a year, and we've been operating ISS for the past decade. And the only Asia companies that are operating ISS are followed by Russia and America. And you know, with a public and private partnership, we've been running ISS. So in post-ISS, how we can exhaustively use Kibo. And today's symposium is Kibo Utilization Symposium. And utilization is not the only thing that we need to think about. And the operation and know-how, what kind of things do we need to succeed? I think that's what the government should be thinking about. And how we transition that and migrate that to the private sector. And as for the development platform that we need to have, while we still have Kibo, we need to test that and migrate that to the private sector. So we should actually develop the strategy having Kibo in center, and the private sector would succeed that. And I think Kibo would be in the center. Maybe Japan, America, and Russia are the only countries that can do that. So only one country to achieve that. So we are really thankful for all the predecessors. And when the private sector play the main role, we need to make a great effort how we can continue to run this. So in the concept of utilization, so that includes the development for the next era. We talked about low awareness level and the cost and how to access. There would be a lot of challenges that we can easily identify. And when we promote, it's not that simple to just improve the awareness. And if we can just go once in 3 months, it's not good enough. Maybe we should actually have more frequent transportation, like 1 week or 1 month. So realistically, to achieve that, what needs to be developed needs to be considered. In the past, common sense in the space industry and the commercial use of the future would be totally different. Yes, transportation frequency is one of them. You know, we need to transfer astronaut and the transportation mission, and also the business mission and the scale would be different. So in the next 7 years, we need to change that and test that in Kibo. Yes, we need to test and absorb the know-how. And before ISS retires, we need to think of how the future state should be. Takada-san, I would like to ask the same question because you work for the trade company. So same for Kanematsu and same for Mitsui. So you partner with the overseas station provider. And you might think, America is already running the station, so we can just collaborate with them. But for Japan's perspective, what kind of positioning and value does Kibo have? Yeah, Kibo module is an excellent module, and all the Japanese wisdom is concentrated in Kibo. So in 7 years, how we exhaustively utilize Kibo would be very critical. And on the other hand, so the Japanese ISS usage amount, that is determined by the contribution level, and only 12.8% and 40 billion yen in a year. So that is what we have secured. So for customers, when we talk with the customers, they say, well, I consulted with JAXA, but we don't get the opportunity to use. So there are a lot of limitations in the use of ISS. So if we can abolish that limitation, so that is what JAXA is thinking about, so we encourage that. And also, if we just rely on JAXA, 12.8% is the only limitation, the limitation of usage we have. So the key is how to make the Japanese companies make the make it a profitable business. So, you know, the how to increase the number of Japanese companies that get involved in the utilization. So we shouldn't be fixated on this 12.8% scope. And also through ISS, the national beer, that. So if we can utilize that, then maybe Japanese companies would consider using Kibo and also the LEO, and also in the post-ISS, not just in Japan, but we would be able to use the LEO. So not just Kibo, but if there's a slot of utilization that Japanese companies can get, that would be great. So when we talk about International Space Station, you know, there would be a lot of modules that are docked, and you think that you can use a lot of things. However, there are a lot of regulation hurdle that we need to overcome. But in terms of business, we want to have the global business. So if there are physical space, we would like to use, and there's a limitation that you said, but we would like that limitation to be released so that the private sector should be able to use.
And what do you think? Yes, there are legal problems and there are some complications, but we only have 7 years left for Kibo, so maybe we should take a bold approach. For example, privatization. JAXA may be able to announce that. That kind of bold approach is necessary to be able to fully utilize that, because 7 years is short. For example, if we actually change the legal bill, it's difficult. We can just announce. If we announce, then media or people will talk about that. That kind of approach is necessary. That the privatization announcement within the 7 years? Yes. Declaration within that 7 years. I think that will stimulate the discussion. I think it's important to do so. So we actually agreed between Japan and the U.S. last year, but that will be overturned and privatized. That kind of bold approach is necessary. If we actually do the conventional approach, we have to have a phased approach. That actually is time-consuming. So you think there are needs, and you want to do this in this short timeline. You cannot do this all. But if we can actually do this partially, and if we can have that kind of possibility, that's going to be great. The Kibo is a very good module, and that's a very good in terms of the effect. The Japanese companies want to use it. Wema-san, what do you think? Yes, as was mentioned, from our point of view, there's only 7 years left until the retirement of ISS or Kibo. So we have a very tight schedule or limited time left. And we share that thinking. We have to change the mechanisms or create the mechanism. Otherwise, we cannot fully utilize. So we agree to that. And the government actually made investment for this ISS and Kibo. And that was actually based upon the demand by the public sector. There's a limitation. How are we going to lead this, the new era or post-2030? How are we going to have a gradient approach or phase approach to move to this private sector-led approach of post-ISS? We understand the challenge. We want to do the breakthrough, but there are some situations that JAXA has. So we cannot just break that wall by hammer. But this kind of dialogue is very important, I think. We can actually talk about various ideas with each other, and that can become a starting point of the change. By the way, after 2030, what's going to happen? After 2030, what's going to happen? Yes, the Kibo is a physical module. What's going to happen to that module? We are considering that. We are wondering what we can do. For example, when it retires at the 2030, it's not like a turn it off and a module disappears. That's not the case. To retire, it's going to take 1 to 3 years. That's the time span required. We cannot just turn off. So after 2030, we have not had enough discussion yet, honestly speaking. So maybe this question is also about the technical question as well. You can actually have docking with other modules and the manned space stay, and there are various functionalities. And then we have this keyboard. But how about the possibility, even if other modules are turned off, keyboard can continue to be used? Is that a possibility? Well, as a free flyer functionality of keyboard alone, it is very difficult to continue to use that because electricity and communication to actually use that as keyboard alone, that's going to be difficult. So keyboard needs to be connected to be usable. So considering that, across countries, if there's a possibility for the extension of the utilization of keyboard, if we say 7 years is not possible, but in the year 8 and year 9, if there's an opportunity to use keyboard until it is finally terminated, would you like to use? Right. Maybe dock that or connect that to other places. That can be a possibility. For example, to the commercial or private sector station, it may be able to be docked. I think that requires some kind of repair or modification to do so. If we can discuss about that kind of options, that's going to be great as well. And to create an independent experiment module, it can be one possibility. And maybe US creates one and we are to use that. That is also another possibility. So cost utilization and possibility of expanding utilization need to be considered in discussing that. Thank you. So changing the topic now. So private public cooperation with JAXA in exploring new market. That's the topic. We talked about the cross-industry approach to create a new market. So I would like to have more deep dive discussion about that. You talked about the barriers high, the difficulty seems to be very high. It looks difficult. So that's an image, and we have to change that image. But what you actually felt yourselves when you actually do this business of space, there can be some complications, hurdles, or paperwork difficulties. You may have had some difficulties. I think that's going to be the hurdles and difficulties that you need to overcome. And for the new entrants, that's going to be very difficult to go over. So it's a very important question to answer. I think Kyo-san, felt a high hurdle. You may think ourselves is a hurdle, and that is the problem. The actual space station, there's a limitation of the volume to use, but after all, how to use the limited resources in a safe manner, that is the important question. When people want to do the experimentation, and then they have to be involved with the planning phase, and where can they do that? And there are only 6 or 7 astronauts, how to assign that resources? And the launch vehicle is limited, where we can use that, that is a competition. And also safety inspections or verifications. And when it's connected, there are some things which we can or cannot. There are limitations and restrictions in that. So resources is limited, and astronauts should not get injured. So we have to secure the safety and make sure that the mission is achieved from there. And we have to optimize that. And there are processes. That is a high hurdle, I think you may feel. And it's not the Kibo mission, but the SpaceX 27. We are using our equipment for that launch, and we have a customer. And for the safety inspection, the customer wanted to change the documentation, and it's too late to change that documentation, and it is hard. So the customers want to make changes right before the launch, but because of the process of the inspection or evaluation, we have to finalize the documentation 1 or 2 months before the launch. So considering the limited resources, how to use that efficiently and safely, that is the process we need to have. And that can be automated in the future, or using AI for that, that can be a possibility. And also the tax payment or application, I think you can use a wizard and also just attach a document and just submit. And when that kind of thing is possible, that can lower the hurdle.
So the effort on the private sector is needed, and also there would be a lot of room for the efficiency improvement. But with that said, there are government-led missions, and safety is paramount. So we cannot just finish just from today. Right now, the negotiation with the customers is needed, and where we can make them understand would be the key. So the audience today might not know what is happening in reality, but manned and unmanned mission would be quite different in terms of hurdle. So when the astronaut is involved, it's much harder, correct? Yes, for astronauts, if they get injured, and if they get burnt, then that's going to be a problem. On Earth, you can just cool it down with water. But on the orbit, there's a kit to treat, but you can't go to the hospital immediately. So the crew's safety is paramount. Of course, vehicle's safety is paramount too. So that's a big difference in the hurdle between manned and unmanned. So the payload, such as cargo or equipment transportation that doesn't involve astronaut, that is actually easier, or still, it's a matter of how to just attach the equipment. Then if it doesn't involve the astronaut, it depends on the mission. And some would need deep involvement of the astronaut, and there are other type of simple operation. So that would change the safety hurdle. There are many experiments to just place the equipment only. So that is much easier. Yoshizawa-san, I want to ask. In case of you, the space DVD is a startup, and you are claiming yourself to be the space trading company. And you entered as a joint venture capital. So what kind of hurdle do you think? So as Kyo-san mentioned, the safety perspective and the cost perspective, I would like to make some comments. In terms of safety, yeah, when we conduct an experiment with astronauts, safety needs to be the paramount criteria. And there's a test, the safety test process. What kind of things that we need to test? We are coming from the outside. We can't really see at a glance. So how to make it easier to understand? And one way to do it would be automation. So that would be an important initiative. Another thing that we could do is maybe to standardize the testing equipment would be one thing. If multiple and variety of experiments can be done using the same equipment, then that equipment has already tested the safety test. So that would lower the hurdle. I think JAXA has already made efforts to do that. So by doing that, we can simply lower the hurdle. And also public-private partnership. Let me add some comments. So the know-how that JAXA has is quite amazing. So if the user wants to do some kind of experiment, Then how, what kind of container shall we put the samples in? Then the safety is secured and maximized effect. So the user side wouldn't have that idea. So maybe the JAXA can share their know-how and maybe make it a pattern to provide advice. Then we can lower the hurdle. Another thing is about cost. So when we launch the rocket, that's very expensive, and compared to the land transportation, the cost is still very high. Going forward, with the advancement of the rocket development, that would decrease the cost in the future. But when we just look at the short term, so the cost would vary depending on the weight. So we want to make it lightweight as much as possible. Or we want to load in the rocket space as much as possible, then the cost per cargo would decrease. So that would be the short-term efforts that we can make. So the hybrid efforts would be the good way to solve those challenges. Thank you. So it's been 5 years since you started your business. So you are communicating with JAXA a lot, so I'm sure you are catching up very quickly. But other companies do not have a lot of opportunities to communicate with JAXA. So based on your experience, is this Kibo utilization, is that the area that you can actually understand without communication with JAXA? Honestly speaking, it's going to be quite challenging. So therefore, maybe with the automation, maybe we might can do away with the communication. And for the past 5 years, we accumulated for know-how, and JAMS have a long history. So having those players, we can reduce the hurdle. Uematsu-san, what did you think? So far, you have been on the provider side, and you need to approach to wider audience. I'm sure you have some challenges that you personally felt. What did you think? So safety, screening, and also cost were mentioned. Yes, one of the reasons that the hurdle is high, those are two safety tests and also cost are the ones that we are recognized. And for safety test, we cannot eliminate that because we need to protect our astronauts. But when we think of commercialization, maybe we need to have the next era where we do not especially treat space. In the future, for example, when you get on the airplane, there are items that you cannot bring in on board. So similar to that, those are the goods that you cannot carry into space. So, but those are the things that you can carry to space. Then that would become more normal. And in terms of cost, yes, transportation cost is very high. So that's a bottleneck. Therefore, for example, like reuse and also the low-cost engine, that kind of research and development needs to be happening. And hopefully that would reduce the cost, and that would contribute to commercialization. So we think we share the same challenges. Thank you. Yes, when it comes to cost, that is the old challenge that we always have when we think about the business. So for Western countries, there are some free service that is provided in the Western countries. So JAXA, is there a possibility that we can provide those services for free? Well, in our internal discussions, the term free has been mentioned. However, there's a legal restrictions and also using the taxpayers' money, and also in terms of equity. From those perspective, it's very difficult to make those services for free. So that's a reality.
Yeah, so we actually discussing including that possibility as well. Sorry about this candid question. And how about the idea from private sector? I think you have a relationship with other countries as well. And there are restrictions. And how do you feel about that? But do you think Kibo is viable to use, even with the restriction? What's the expectation to JAXA? Can I? Yes. And the utilization of Kibo has restriction, but the post-ISS or post-2030, the private sector is going to take a leading role, considering that legal systems and also whether the Japan is going to tackle on the LEO or activities in a full-fledged manner. That needs to be considered. For example, the state, Ministry of State, Department of State is involved in U.S., and they have a $50 billion budget to actually have the semiconductor manufacturing back in the U.S. Maybe part of that can be used for the space activities, because the space activity is contributing to businesses. And the Cabinet Office, Ministry of Welfare, as well as METI and MIC, we can actually have all Japan approach for the space activities. And then we can create a great momentum. And considering the legal system restriction, we have IGA. So we have no problems about the tariffs, maybe pause, or maybe intellectual property law for space activity or air traffic law, and also foreign exchange law. Those various laws can be involved as well. So we need to have all Japan approach with all the stakeholders. Thank you. There are two hints there. One is there are various rules. And in space, we may say, we went to 17, actually, the bureaucrats in Kasumigaseki in one day. Space-related people may say that way. That route to be created may be necessary, that it's also necessary for the general rocket launch as well. And another point is maybe vision, because Kibo utilization price, rather than whether it's free or not, we have to consider the return would be there. If return is high, then people think about making the market without considering just paying the price or not. And I think that is going to be the requirement of all people, rather than just the price. I think you have mentioned the word vision in your talk. So do you have any visions that you can talk about here? And keyword was maybe Department of Commerce, and what we are going to do for the industries. Who is going to take initiative? Can I? And for the, it's not a request to the ministries or our agencies. This is our vision. Sheila Space is where we are working with, and the small satellite is actually developed that can actually land in the airport. And in terms of the vision, we can make sure that we can actually make profit on the Earth that can actually make the economic zone. We have partnership with the OITA, Prefecture and JAL as well. Space station creates something, and actually we can actually take something that is back to the Earth. And then those who are not related with the space can get involved with this approach, and we can make a great industry that is a good, a big economy, that is a gigantic vision. And my boss is criticizing it, it's too big a vision. Each company can actually talk about those ideas that will lead to the realization of the potential. How about Haruguchi-san? Well, other people, to get involved, I think vision is necessary to involve many other stakeholders, and cost, and also duration or length of time is important. We actually submit the application because we are user of the Kibo, others, so we actually submit the application. Considering that perspective, when we do the business, what is difficult is when the schedule is not visible. We don't see the schedule. That is very tough, because we are a private listed company, so we have to actually explain to the shareholders, and we have to be able to explain the schedule, because that will lead to when we can make money. And when we submit the application, we can use only 2 years ahead or 3 years ahead. when we make plan, we actually consider the market and decide whether we should enter that market or not. And if it takes 2 years or 3 years, we cannot say what's going to happen to that market in 2 years or 3 years. When it's going to be launched, that kind of schedule needs to be very clear, not only like what year. We have to be able to see what month the launch is going to happen. And that's a personal opinion. With that visibility of the schedule, and then all those companies will be able to have vision. So fixation of that schedule is very important. That the fixation of the schedule is not only the transport. Yeah, for example, when we can send the staff to the space station, what month we can do that, that it's important to understand. For space activities, schedule changes, that happens quite often. But the predictability, including that the schedule, it's not so available. Is that the problem? Yes. The schedule is a very, very variable now. And also, we have to consider the budget approval, because we have budget approval for each year. If time delays, it has big impact. As a space-related organization, you have each year's budget, and that budget is decided on the previous year, and you accumulate that investment. So it's very difficult to make a long-term commitment. That I think that's the difference from the private sector companies. Yes, when we consider the commercialization and the businesses, if you don't know the clear schedule, that is quite hard. That's a problem, I understand. And at the same time, launch of the space rocket, we have to meet the various conditions. And currently, in terms of the capacity of launch, there are restrictions, limitations. We can launch once a week. There are various satellites, various services, and there's a competition with that. And the spaceship Konotori, we want to launch at a certain time, and there was a conflict of the schedule with the other space vehicle. We were not able to have that schedule. That is the current situation. That's the reality in terms of the infrastructure. So when we think about the future businesses, we should be able to launch more frequently. We have to improve this technology as well as the infrastructure. That is a challenge. I understand that. We don't have a clear solution to that challenge, but in order to commercialize, that is a big hurdle, big barrier, I think.
Yoshida-san, please. So technically, we need to overcome those challenges, but also for the short term, how we try to solve those issues with commercial approach, insurance could be one idea. So we launched the satellite. So if there's a delay, we can provide insurance service. So those kind of services can be newly developed. Then the negative impact for the private sector can be mitigated. So we need to think about that combination. Thank you. So from a different angle, I have questions to you. So in the Uematsu-san's presentation, one of the things we need to do is the U.S.-Japan partnership to expand the commercialization. You already partner with U.S. companies. So when we talk about public-private partnership, so before considering the sustainable scenario of LEO activities, you are doing with the self-help efforts. But by collaborating with JAXA, any request for JAXA to do in terms of U.S.-Japan collaboration? Well, entering into the U.S. market is what the Japanese private sector was not really good at. So if we can overcome that hurdle with the public-private partnership, that would be great. So that's what I thought. What do you think? So in that sense, so what is the Japanese strength? Maybe we need to think about that together. And 40 billion yen was the amount, and HTV transportation is the main thing that we are using that money, and that's a very good technology. So maybe HTVX can be promoted. And if the other companies use this technology, we can receive cash. So that's one way of collaboration. And also for HTV launch and HTC can be sold. So we should paint the big picture and how the Japanese private companies can get into that. So that's what we can think about together with JAXA. And I found it disappointing. The Axiom Space module, the Tarsalania has taken the orders, but you know we had Japan's Kibo. So if we collaborated with JAXA, we could have been able to sell the Japanese technologies. So we shouldn't be missing those opportunities. So that's something we need to really collaborate with JAXA. Maybe I would be scolded if I say these kind of things, but yeah, with the four platforms. So which company would win in the US commercial space, and where we can get the opportunities to get orders of the Japanese technologies. So that kind of connection would be very important, and collecting information and a lot of communication should be activated between the US and Japan. And I think JAXA can provide a lot of information on NASA. So is that one way of collaboration? Yes, honestly, and with the, that kind of discussion has taken place in the past. Yes, we need to enhance that communication. So as the space agency, neutrality and responsibility of information management is there, but in business, you need to give like a very hidden information. Although there are like restrictions, but do you think you can overcome those hurdles? Like providing like underground information to the private partners. Well, for Japanese companies, I want them to enter into the overseas and global market, and JAXA wants to support that. However, when it comes to the equality and fairness, because we are like government led, so we need to be mindful of that. Yes, we need to be mindful of the balance, but this kind of dialogue is very critical. So we hope to find the common strategies. So in that sense, in terms of the scope of the investigation, this framework should welcome many private sector players. Imamoto-san, any comments? In collaborating with the US companies, you can just rely on Japanese private sector, what kind of business they should be doing, what kind of technology we're going to promote, and how to collaborate. So if you are saying it should be led by private sector, that should be on the effort on the private sector. But once we have the seeds and the stories, as Tanaka-san said, you need to revise the regulations smoothly, or the IP and the licenses should be granted. So that kind of collaboration would be needed. So you can freely move these around, and once there are seeds, you should gently push our back. So that would be the good way of your support. Maybe this is not the right way to say it, but if the space agency gets involved too much, you can only work within the limitation of fairness. So you should give more delegation to the private sector. And also today's, it's not about the free of charge or charged. So this is a long-term project. And it wouldn't be related to the public policy as well. So as Japan, so you have a high expectation on the LEO activities. We can be the ones to paint the picture, but have that high expectation, it's very important, and that's what we want the government to do. So if you just don't care about LEO, then the private sector can't really do those long-term projects. So government should announce the significance of LEO activities and put that in the public policy as well. with the, you know, in terms of the facing with the U.S. You know, companies, the Japanese private sector should take the lead. So that's not what we are expecting JAXA to do. And this is related to the first part discussion. But Yamamoto-san talked about how to create the avenue, and that is very important to have the collaboration avenue. So partnering with the U.S. and to have the dialogue in the equal footing. So we have this, you know, a good experiment in you know, a platform that we can provide. So, you know, the important thing is how to have that dialogue avenue. And maybe JAXA can support that, and also that's where the government can help. The anchor tenancy could be one topic that you might think of. And you know, the private sector is not just, you know, wanting that only. So depending on the outcome, you know, we get paid later. So if that kind of flexible scheme exists, then we can you know, fund the cash that we need.
Yes, as a private sector company, if we wait for the movement of the government and take action, then we cannot win the competition and we cannot actually create the market. If the company actually takes risks, they should be provided with opportunities. Maybe that's a right path. I talked about the vision, and in US, the public sector companies actually create vision and then make announcement. It's not that the public sector create the vision and wait for that. In Japan, we tend to wait for that. But in the US, they create the vision and create the roadmap and ask the government to support that. I think that is a good approach. And since this company actually took the risk and get advanced approach, so the JAXA is helping you. I think that should be the way. And from Slido, we got the question. So I'd like to pick up one question. For the 2030, can we have a criteria of fully utilization of Kibo? So this question is to JAXA, but I think we can ask all the panelists to answer a question, but maybe choose two people. If you can think you fully utilized that Kibo, what needs to be done? With what you would be thinking full utilization was achieved? Can I? Consumer, or if we can actually elicit the consumer to the people in general, I think we say we had the full utilization. Currently, it is limited to the academia or companies, but it's not for the consumers. If we can do the two consumers usage, then I think we can say there was commercialized or utilized fully, B2B2C or B2B2G2C. Maybe it was a question addressing to me, but I'm an engineer in my nature, so maybe I cannot give you an interesting answer, but full utilization by 2030. In order to feel that way, the equipment is too obsolete or worn out, and we cannot do that anymore. If we actually used to that end, we would be able to say we fully utilized. That's the from the perspective of developer. So JAXA and the public companies should use that until the Kibo breaks down or worn out. Thank you. It was an engineer-like answer. And I'd like to get the message from each one of you to the business people, the business owners and manager. And that can be your partners or the companies who take followership. From the panel discussion of today, maybe please mention the most interesting keyword that you felt and the message to those business. And can I ask you to start, Mr. Kyo? Thank you. And we talked about having places. So full utilization of Kibo was also mentioned. For after 2030, the manned space activity, and we should be able to show that, showcase it. It's important. And even if we use a U.S. Space station or a Japanese unique space station, we should be able to showcase it. Not only hardware, we should have a communication place or where we can have communication in this way. So in terms of message, it's simple. But well, I say this often, space station is only 400 kilometers away. It is from Tokyo to Osaka. That's the distance. So not only using the space, and we can use, this is no gravity love. And that should be the way. It's not something special. And then business owners would be able to use that and consider the usage from the value that is provided from space station. Mr. Yamamoto, please. The keyword that was interesting was mission, vision, and strategy. How we are going to consider from national government level and also companies level, we need to have that. That is important. And the message to the business people, maybe I'm not in the position to say this, but there are some. Space is not only satellite. People think the satellite and the measurement and also imaging. And when you think a space station, you just think astronauts. That's not the case. It's not that's not everything. And the usage will expand material, communication, or entertainment, or others. There are many possibilities that will overlap with the business areas that people have. So if you feel that way, then you can actually have a solid approach to utilize that technology for space. And we like to work with that. Thank you. Horiguchi-san, please. Well, this is a message to business owners or business people. And there are markets. Markets not created yet. We don't see the market yet. That's only for space industry. From business executives, they're creating the market or harvesting the market results. Concerning that, there are a lot of potentials. If there's a high risk, of course, the return is also high. In that sense, we can actually talk about various ideas. And if everybody actually get involved and take part in, that's going to be great. I want to cooperate with those business people. Thank you. Mr. Ryo Yoshizawa? Yes, I'm Yoshizawa Ryo. I should look good in speaking as Ryo Yoshizawa. So message, concerning what has been mentioned, the cooperation with the U.S. and also involvement of other people, stakeholders. And we like to create the industry which represents Japan. That is the starting thinking in why space. And without actually harming the environment of Earth, in maybe deep sea or space, the quite limited areas that we can touch on. And we have the mission to create the industry. And of course, we alone cannot do that. And we five companies alone cannot do this either. And more players to take part is very necessary. And users to use that, or maybe people should become the provider of the solutions. If we have more and more players, and potential will become bigger, and we can actually explore the demands. That is what we would like to lead to. So please work with us. That's the message. Mr. Ryo Yoshizawa, thank you. Takada-san, please. Well, it's a great opportunity. Thank you very much for this opportunity. And what Shioka-san said, the friendship that was mentioned at the beginning. And as Yoshizawa-san mentioned right now, space is very attractive. But from now on, it's a money-making or profitable industry. And there are companies who are tackling on this industry. Please become friends to us. We are a trading company, and we have supported many Japanese companies as a friend or fellows. We like to work with you to create this industry. and develop this industry. So to please become fellows, friends. And I was concerned, what is this alligator? Why alligator for the astronauts? When we go to the Kennedy Space Center, there are many alligators around. So that's the reason why. Oh, thank you very much.
So when you go to the Kennedy Center, watch out of the alligator. So next to Uematsu-san, please. Thank you. I enjoyed it so much. After listening to all the panelists, I strongly felt that I shouldn't be afraid of the new landscape. I should have the courage and walk towards the new landscape. So I was empowered and encouraged. Thank you very much. Thank you, all the panelists. I think the message was very well conveyed through this time. I also thought that the satellite was the main, you know, image of the space. But you know, as a next frontier, it is changing. And you are also taking the risk and proactively challenging yourself to build business there. So you are not the only ones. So you would be the frontiers. And you should make the private sector community and lead JAXA along the way and expand the community going forward. In overseas, the microsatellite community exists. So you shouldn't be fixated on the official format. I think if you build the community, we can find the better opportunities going forward. So now we would like to finish this session. I think it was a very active and fruitful discussion. Thank you very much for all the panelists. Thank you. So did you speak what you wanted to say? You feel quite refreshed. You look quite refreshed. So the safety, cost would be the challenges, and also having the schedule very difficult to develop the schedule. So I realized that there are many difficult hurdles. But now you know that those hurdles are, you know, the ones that we need to tackle. I think you can actually collaborate more. Thank you for the facilitating, and please give a big round of applause to all the panelists today. So please return to your seat. Thank you very much. So it was about the total of 100 minutes. You know, we are still broadcasting. So if you could leave the stage first, and we can take the group photo later on. Please give another big round of applause. Thank you. So after this, we will have the lunch break. And at 12:30, we will start the second part. It's 1:30. Sorry, mistake. From 1:30 p.m., we will start the second part is the Japan-U.S. Partnership for the LEO activities. And we have some housekeeping notes. So this ISS Kibo Utilization Symposium, actually there's a special program before the symposium. There's a YouTube video, and there's a QR code on the brochure. So you can read the QR code, and also you can check the YouTube. And also on the YouTube overview section, there's a link of that special program. And also the Kibo Robot Programming Challenge organized by JAXA, and the students who won the third place, and also the astronaut Mr. Onishi would appear, and also other JAXA employees are also appearing in the program. I encourage you to check the video. So we will start from 1:30 p.m., so I will see you in 1 hour. Thank you very much.